Hi, and welcome to Chapter 13. We're going to talk about costs and production and the costs of that production, but first let's go ahead and do a couple of definitions here. First of all, we assume that the firm's goal is always to maximize their profit. That's simple, just it's the way that we arrive at our equilibrium ideas is that we know the firm always wants to maximize profit. What is this profit? It's total revenue minus the total cost. Revenue is the amount of money that they get from sales. That's also P times Q minus the total cost. We're going to talk about the costs in more detail in this chapter. Okay? And so first, let's think about the type of costs there are. There's explicit costs, the actual financial or pecuniary costs of paying wages to workers or any sort of rent for capital. There's also the implicit costs. Remember way back in chapter one, we talked about the cost of something is what you give up to get it. The opportunity cost of the owner's time or the owner's capital that they put into it, that also has to be considered when we're talking about our costs. Okay, so both of these matter for the firm's decisions. Here's an example. So let's say you need $100,000 to start your business and the interest rate currently is 5%. Well, the first thing you could do is go ahead and borrow $100,000 from a bank. All right, the explicit cost here would be $5,000 interest on the loan. $100,000 that you need, the 5% rate of interest. So you are going to end up costing you $5,000 interest on loan. That's also the total cost in case one is $5,000. In case two, let's make it a little more complicated. Use $40,000 of your own savings, borrow, and you borrow the $60,000. So there is, in fact, an explicit cost of $3,000, which is $60,000 times 5% on the loan. And if you stop there, you might think it's cheaper to use case two. However, you're forgetting about the implicit cost, okay? You could have taken that $40,000 instead of using it in your business, put it in the bank, and earned 5% interest on it. So you could have earned that extra $2,000. You're giving that up, therefore it's an opportunity cost. Therefore, in both cases, the total costs are $5,000. Okay, so now that we've talked about the different type of costs, we'll talk about the different type of profits because they're very related. In counting profit, only thinks about explicit costs, okay? Whereas economic profit, thinks about the total cost, both explicit and implicit costs. And accounting profit doesn't include implicit costs, so it's gonna be higher than economic profit. And in a couple of chapters, we're gonna see that in a lot of market structures, firms end up earning zero economic profit. If you're thinking of accounting profit, you might think, how can this happen? If firms are earning zero profit, how can they continue to stay open? That's because they're earning a positive amount of accounting profit, but zero economic profit. Okay, so let's do a quick little example. So the equilibrium rent on office space is just increased by $500 a month. Okay, determine the effects on both accounting and economic profit if, perhaps let's say you rent your office space, or maybe you own your office space. Oops, too far. So go ahead and take a couple seconds and think about both what accounting and economic profit is gonna be like if, in case A and B, if the equilibrium rent increases by $500 a month. All right, so welcome back. Here's what we have. If you rent your office space, the explicit costs increase $500 a month. And so therefore accounting profit and economic profit both fall $500 a month because this is an explicit cost every month you're paying the rent on your office space. But let's suppose you own your office space, okay? Explicit costs are not gonna change because you're not actually having an outlaying of financial money every single month. But the implicit costs, the cost that you could get if you rented out your office space to someone else, does increase by $500 a month. So economic profit alone falls by $500 per month. Okay, I really want you to be thinking about economic profit when we're talking about profit from here on out. All right, let's talk about the production function. This is how we stipulate what number of inputs produces a quantity of outputs. All right, so we can represent with a table, equation, or graph. In this course, we're just gonna be looking at tables and graphs. So here's an example. Farmer Jack is growing wheat. He's 5 acres of land. He can hire as many workers as he wants. Let's look at what this looks like. So if he ends up hiring 0 workers, he produces 0 wheat. And as you can see on the graph, that gives us an output of 0 right here. Okay, but let's see what happens if he hires one person. Okay, he produces 1,000 bushels of wheat, and we have the corresponding point on our graph. Let's hire another person. We can make 1,800 bushels of wheat, and let's plot it on the graph. All right, let's keep doing this for up to 5 workers. All right, so you see we've plotted a function here. We're going to call this the production function, all right? And I can connect these things with a line. The marginal product is a very interesting thing to think of. Remember that we always want to think on the margin, which means the next step. So the marginal product of labor is, if I hire one additional person, how much more product will I get? All right, so we introduce this delta, this uppercase Greek letter, and it means a change in. So we have a change in output for a change in labor, and when we divide those, that's the marginal product of labor. Generally, what we think about is we're gonna make this number be 1. So if I hire one additional person, what additional output do I have? That's kind of the question that I'm asking. All right, so let's look at the marginal product of labor. This is pretty easy. If I go from 0 to 1 worker, I have 1,000 additional change in quantity. So 1,000 divided by 1 is just equal to 1,000 marginal product of labor. But look at this second guy. If I go from this guy 1 to 2 workers, I only get 800 additional bushels of wheat. So the marginal product of labor here is 800. Let's do the same thing for guy number 2 to 3. I get an extra 600. Guy number 3 to 4, I get an extra 400. Guy number 4 to 5, I get an extra 200. Okay, so this is the marginal product of labor. And conveniently, you see that I write this on exactly in between the points. It's not aligned exactly with any line over here because it tells you this is the number that happens between 0 and 1. So let's go ahead and talk about how this equals the slope of the production function. So at any point, it starts out being steep, and then it gets less steep because each additional person is worth less. This is why the production function gets flatter as the amount of labor I have. That's what L stands for. Labor increases. The production function gets flatter because each individual worker is actually worth less to me in terms of their output. Their marginal product of labor is diminishing. And so if you look at the production function, you can see that in fact the slope down here is rather steep and the slope up here is rather flat. It's getting closer to zero, and that is the graphical representation of this diminishing marginal product of labor. Okay? You see at 800 from guy 1 to 2, it's 800 the slope is, and then the slope decreases to 600, the slope decreases again to 400, the slope decreases again to 200. It's getting flatter. So why is this important? Well, we always want to make our decision at the margin. So Farmer Jack is going to ask, when I hire one extra worker, okay, I know my costs are going to rise by whatever the wage is, and my output is going to rise by the marginal product of that laborer. So Farmer Jack, his decision-making process is going to say, look, is it worth more to me? Is the guy's MPL worth more to me than the cost costs me? And if it is, then he wants to hire the additional worker. Okay, and why does this diminish? Well, basically, you got to think of it like this. Imagine the farm is a set amount of land. Okay, it's a fixed amount. And so the more people we have, the less land each individual worker has to be productive. So whether the fixed input is land or capital, perhaps a factory, there's only so much factory space, and as you keep packing more and more workers in there, they have less room for each of them to work, it diminishes, all right? And this only happens when there's a fixed input, such as land or capital. All right, so let's look at an example. So Farmer Jack is paying $1,000 per month for the land. That's perhaps what he's renting, or perhaps maybe that's his opportunity cost if he owns the land of his own self. So the market farm wage for a farm worker is $2,000 per month, no matter how many workers you buy. So Farmer Jack's costs are related to how much wheat he produces. And let's go ahead and throw in this. We've already seen the left two columns. Let's add the cost of land. The cost of labor is just $2,000 per worker, so that's an easy column to compute. And so the total cost, we're just going to add land and labor together, and we have a total cost column right here. All right, so his total cost curve, I'm just going to go ahead and take the the Q column and the total cost column and plot them so I can see what it looks like. All right, so I put quantity of wheat on the x-axis, total cost on the y-axis, and I see that I have something that is increasing in slope. That is, the slope gets steeper as I get up here. That's because each guy is producing less. As I produce more wheat, I have to hire more workers. Each worker is producing less because his marginal product is decreasing, and so it's just costing more. It's not as efficient. All right, marginal cost is the slope of the total cost curve. And it is increasing, as we'll see, as I produce more wheat. So as I go from 0 to 1,000 bushels of wheat, all right, I hire one additional person, so my total cost goes up by $2,000. So what's my marginal cost? Well, $2,000 divided into the 1,000 bushels of wheat, it's $2 per bushel of wheat. But when I go from one worker to two workers, that's 1,000 to 1,800 bushels of wheat, my total cost still goes up by $2,000, the price of the extra worker, but he doesn't produce as much, so 2,000 divided by 800 gives us this 250 over here in the marginal cost column, okay? Let's do that again for the next worker, right? 2,000 divided by 600 now is 333. And so forth down the graph, and I see that my marginal cost is actually increasing as I produce more. So each unit is actually costing more to produce, each bushel of wheat is costing more to produce as I produce more. So marginal cost usually rises as Q rises, like we show in this example. Again, notice I put the marginal cost here in between the line over here because it's going from 0 to 1,000, so the marginal cost belongs in between the two. When I graph it, it looks like this. We have a marginal cost that is getting more and more steep. So the marginal cost curve itself is just the slope of the total cost curve, which is increasing. All right, why is this important? Well, Farmer Jack always has to ask, should I produce one more bushel of wheat? And every time he does, he wants to compare the marginal cost to the marginal product of labor, thinking at the margin. So he asks, if the cost of producing one thing of additional wheat, that's a marginal cost, is less than the revenue he would get from selling it, he should definitely make more wheat, produce more wheat. Okay? And so we need to think about fixed and variable costs. They do not vary. Fixed costs do not vary with the quantity of output produced. Fixed cost in this example was $1,000. It's $1,000 every month, no matter how much wheat he produces. Okay. In other examples in real life, we can have the cost of equipment or loan payments or maybe contracted rent. Perhaps you have to rent your factory space and you have to pay the same amount every single pay period. Variable costs, however, are costs that do vary with the quantity produced. So variable costs in this example are the wages he pays workers, right? As he produces more, he has to hire more, and therefore he's going to pay his more wages, all right? Also, if we would have had him using some materials, then the cost of those materials are variable costs. The total cost at any time is fixed cost plus the variable cost. All right, so let's do a really general example. Applies to any type of firm. Let's say that the fixed cost is 100, no matter what quantity they produce. And so let's graph that. Along the entire quantity, there is a cost of 100, and so it's a flat line. Variable costs, however, let's say that they're going up. Okay, this is the, let's say, the number of laborers that we're purchasing. Okay, if we want to make one unit of output, it's going to cost us $70 of labor. If you want to make two units of output, it's going to cost us $120 in labor. So this is always increasing just because I'm having to hire more workers and perhaps more raw materials to make it. The variable cost curve then is going to be graphed looking like this. It increases. This makes sense. As I make more, I need to use more inputs, therefore the cost is increasing. Total cost is simple. We just add the fixed cost and the variable cost together. And then the graph is going to look very, very similar. I want to point out that the distance between these things is the fixed cost divided by how many units that we've produced. So notice it gets closer together over here because the fixed cost is spread over 7 units here versus spread over 1 unit over here. All right, so let's go ahead and calculate the marginal cost here. I've done it for you. Again, I put the marginal cost halfway in between the lines, so you see it's the cost of going from 0 to 1 unit. Okay, that's the formula that we use to calculate it. And usually, don't forget, marginal cost rises because of diminishing marginal product of labor. Okay, so as I hire more workers, remember they're less effective. Therefore, that each additional unit of output that I want to produce at high levels of output is more expensive because I have to hire more people. Now here, we might have the marginal cost falling slightly and then rising in the end. Okay, but we might have constant marginal cost. But so the marginal cost curve then graphed looks just exactly like this. Just transferred it over there. Again, marginal cost is graphed on the half points, you see, because it indicates it goes from 0 to 1, and so you graph on the half point. 1 to 2, you graph this on the half point. In the Applia homework, that's also what it'll be like. You'll have to graph it on the halfway points. All right, average fixed cost. So this is pretty easy. The fixed cost is always 100, but then we just divide it by the number of output we have. So it's kind of like how the total fixed cost, but then spread out among all of my quantity. And so we go and calculate that, and it's a pretty easy thing to calculate. So average fixed cost falls because the cost is being spread over a larger number of units. And the average fixed cost then graph looks like this. Average variable cost. So this is the variable cost divided by the quantity of output. So you've already seen those first two columns. If I divide the column 2 by the quantity column, I get the average variable cost column. And as you can see also, AVC may fall initially, but then it rises as output rises. We'll talk a little bit more about why that happens, but you get kind of like this U-shaped line for average variable cost. Okay, average total cost. And this is pretty easy. This is just the total cost divided by Q. So I have my total cost, I divide it by my output, and I get the average total cost column as shown. There's another easier way to calculate it. This perhaps you might find easier. You just take the average fixed cost plus the average variable cost, and this will give you the average total cost. Okay, so I pulled in the average fixed cost and average variable cost, these two columns right here. You've already seen these two columns from the previous slides, but if I add them together at any point, I get the average total cost. So whatever's easier, use either formula. Okay, and so we have the ATC curve being U-shaped as well. Now, let's keep the ATC curve. Let's put the AVC curve there. Remember, the difference between average variable cost and average total cost at any one point, this is the average fixed cost in between, and notice it's getting closer and closer together because the average fixed cost is decreasing. The average fixed cost, like I said, is decreasing, and then we have marginal cost, and it's coming through right here. So this is all the curves on the graph together. It gets a little messy, but these are all the curves, the cost curves that we need to pay attention to. All right, so I want you to go ahead and practice filling in the blank spaces of the table. You have it in your notes. Go ahead and do this, and then I'll give you the answers. Okay, here we go. You have to realize the fixed cost is 50 because at quantity equals 0, there's still a total cost of 50. So fixed cost is 50. And then you can go ahead and use the fact that fixed cost plus variable cost equals total cost. And now you're going to use average fixed cost formula, and you figure that out. All right, and finally, you'll use the average variable cost formula to fill out that column. Okay, and then the rest is pretty straightforward. All right, and those are the answers. Now, why is ATC U-shaped? Well, as quantity rises, initially, the average fixed cost is getting smaller, right? Because there's one fixed cost that's getting spread out into more units, so it's cheaper to produce these units because the average fixed cost is getting spread out into more units, and that's what's making the ATC go down. However, remember, the average variable cost starts increasing. As I produce more and more units, it costs more. I have to hire more people. And so the variable cost starts getting out of control, and it starts pulling the ATC up. Okay, so that point where it's the cheapest or the average total cost is at the minimum, we call that the efficient scale. Memorize that word because it comes up later when we're talking about monopolistic competition. We want to produce at the bottom of the ATC curve. It's better for society. And if I throw the marginal cost curve on here, you're going to notice this really important aspect. When the marginal cost curve is below the ATC curve, you see what happens? The ATC curve falls. However, when the marginal cost curve ends up being above, right, so we have the marginal cost curve here above the average total cost curve, the average total cost curve ends up curving upwards, okay? So essentially, the marginal cost curve always crosses the ATC curve at the minimum point. So if you want to know where this efficient scale place is, if it perhaps it's difficult to see the bottom of the ATC curve, simply set the ATC curve equal to the marginal cost curve and you know you've gotten to the bottom of the ATC curve. All right, let's talk about short run and long run costs. In the short run, the definition of how long is the short run, it's whatever length of time that some inputs are still fixed. And the costs are called fixed costs. In the long run, however, all costs turn into variable costs, right? So let's say that it takes a firm 1 year to build a new factory. Well, the border between short run and long run is then 1 year, because in less than 1 year, it's fixed at the number of factories. But after 1 year, if you think 2 years down the road, this firm can make two factories or sell its other factories. So that it's therefore a variable cost and we're in the long run, okay? And so, and the ATC at any quantity is the cost per unit using the most efficient mix of inputs for that quantity. So it's basically the lowest ATC given that I can change my factory size. So let's look at how that looks. So here's my average total cost, and let's say the firm can choose between three factory sizes. So we're thinking about in the long run here. That's why at the top it says long run average total cost. And each firm factory size has its own short run average total cost curve. So let's say that there is an average total cost curve like this for the small size factory, and then in the long run it could turn itself into a medium size factory and it has an average total cost curve that looks like that, and the large factory has an average total cost curve that looks like that. Notice that the medium is shifted slightly over from the small and the large is shifted slightly over from the medium, just because that's the point. A larger factory is more efficient, making more units of goods. So in the long run, the firm can change to a different factory size. So its long run average total cost curve, actually let's back up a little bit. If a firm is going to make less than quantity A, then it's clearly cheaper to be on the average total cost curve for the small factory, and it's going to have a small factory. Okay, if it's going to produce somewhere in here, it's cheapest to do it with a medium-sized factory, so it'll choose a medium factory. And if it's going to produce a lot, obviously it's cheaper to produce it in a large factory. So the long-run average total cost curve is just the bottom or the cheapest way that the firm can make the good. Okay? Because in the long run, the firm can change between factory sizes. So in the real world, there's not just three types of factories. There's probably at least 20 different sizes of factories, maybe 100, maybe an infinite kind of gradation on the size of factories. So the long run average total cost curve looks like this red thing here. All right. And so as in the long run, as the long run average total cost curve is falling, we call that economies of scale, right? If it's getting cheaper to produce a good at this point, we want to keep producing more. So we want to keep growing our factory bigger and bigger. This is called economies of scale. All right, and over this period, look, there's just no real returns from having a bigger company. So we call that constant returns of scale. And here it actually starts getting more expensive if I'm producing more quantity. It's perhaps just too hard to manage. And it's called diseconomies of scale. We want to not be in this section. All right. So economies of scale occur when Q is low generally, because then instead of only one employee having to do all the jobs, we can get the employees into little groups and specialize, and they can become more efficient on what they're doing. Okay. However, as the size of this company grows, we have coordination problems. Management can't handle everything, and they can't control costs because they're not able to check in on everybody just because there's so many workers. And Q, when it's high, it ends up having what's called diseconomies of scale, or an increasing average total cost function.